Hello, everybody. This is Brother Luke, Sin City Preacher. Welcome to this episode of Bible Talk with Brother Luke. This is part four of the series we're doing. We titled it Macarthur, Piper, and Washer versus John, Peter, and Paul. And tonight, we're the subtitle is, Is It Believe or Behave? What must we do to be saved? Is it believe or behave to be saved? Now, before we get into that, though, let's introduce the panelists, and I want to kind of recap the last show real briefly, and then we'll move on. Okay, so whoever talks first gets to introduce yourself.
Hey, guys. This is Austin here. My YouTube channel is Austin Bell. I run a online ministry called Christ Ministries. We do online evangelical soul winning. Anybody's interested, just shoot me a message.
Okay. All right, Austin, thank you very much. Is anybody contacting you with these little promos you're doing for your work?
I got one person, but I got in contact through him through another brother's video.
Oh, okay. All right, and Brother Joseph, say hi to everybody.
Hello, everyone. This is a Jay Byron channel, Joe, and glad to be here. Love the studies. Look forward to it.
Okay, brother. Thank you. And Brother Eric.
Hi, I'm Eric. My YouTube channel is JesusKnight72. Feel free to shoot me a message anytime. I don't have an actual ministry through my channel, but I do favorite videos and ideas that we seem to share. So hopefully could add something good to the panel.
Mm-hmm. Well, one thing I want to correct, Eric, and you, someone else said this too in one of their introductions, that they don't have a ministry. And everybody does have a ministry, just some people are doing more with it than others. And if you did nothing else, you're participating in this discussion, and I think that's a worthy ministry to be part of.
Absolutely.
Sister Tanya.
Hello, everybody. My name is Galaxy Dreams 3 on YouTube. My channel is just me vlogging about my Christian walk and Bible studies I do and just things like that. So, and it's good to be here, and I look forward to the study today.
Okay, very good. Thank you very much. My goal in these discussions, even though I'm the host, I like to have the words fairly equally divided. if there's five of us and each of us said about 20% of the words, that would just make me really happy. But some people talk more than others, and in my case, I have to talk a little bit more because I'm trying to guide this. I don't want anybody to take this as that I'm doing a teaching. I'm a participant, but I'm also a moderator or a facilitator. I'm trying to make sure that the topic that we're on and the outline I prepared, that we are kind of staying on that subject and not getting off too much into other random things, even though sometimes it's worthwhile to do that too. But I want to make a little bit of a speech here in the beginning just to kind of recap a couple of things and make a couple of key points, and then I'm hoping everybody else will do most of the talking. When we started off in the first episode, we laid a foundation that proved that salvation comes by faith alone, that it does not come by works, and it does not come by a combination of faith and works. So if you need proof of that, you should watch part one of this series. And then when we got into part two, we started discussing some of the confusing, controversial verses that people use to try to point out that, well, faith is not enough. There's some works are required. And so we've been discussing those. And the first verses that we got to were from the book of James, and we answered several of them as best we could. And then last episode, I decided to take a different approach with the book of James. Instead of going verse by verse and trying to explain it away, I decided to explain away the entire book of James, as far as I made the case that James has nothing to do with our message of salvation. That the book of James is really the argument that against Paul and simply believing for salvation. So go, you can go back and watch that, and I have a playlist now. I think it's Shocking Facts about the Book of James. So go to that playlist. I have a couple of videos on it, and Brother Mitchell Belenkov has a couple of videos on it now, and you can get caught up on that. But let me say something just in general about a philosophy of life in a way. I think that over the years, I've changed my opinion on some theological topics, but I don't change my opinion very easily. I've always held to the basic idea that the majority opinion and whatever is considered orthodoxy is I'm going to embrace that unless I'm convinced that it's wrong. However, we know that the majority is not always right. And the easiest way to point that out is if you look at religion of the world as a whole, and then even more narrowly, if you look at just what's called Christendom, all those religions that fall under this umbrella of Christian, that, well, we don't believe they're all really Christian, but what is the major belief of the majority? It's that you're saved based upon behaving. If you behave yourself, you might be able to go to heaven if you do well. But what we all agree and what the scriptures say is that we're saved because we believe, not because we behave. So we can see right now, right there, that the vast majority of people are wrong in the most fundamental thing. So thinking that we've got to always hold the majority position or the orthodox position can be a big mistake. I'll give you a couple of examples of ways that I've changed. I held a position that the KJV version of the Bible was the only one that we should study, and the others are all perverted. And I held that and defended it for many years. But I was willing to discuss it with people, and because I had an open mind, I was willing to give people a fair hearing. Eventually, I was persuaded, and now I do not hold to the KJV only position. The same thing has taken place as I defended the doctrine of the eternal torment in hell for the unbeliever. I defended it every way that you can for many years. And eventually, because I was willing to listen to the other point of view, I finally conceded and said, no, I'm no longer holding to that position. There's other things too. Something recently that I think I gave a fair hearing to is in eschatology, you know, I've always believed in the pre-tribulation rapture and the premillennial return of Jesus to set up his kingdom. But about 6 months ago, Tanya told me that Eve and her friend Jerry wanted to do a teaching on preterism, and I only knew just the basics of preterism, so I agreed to participate and hear them out. And I believe that Tanya and I gave them a very fair hearing. They had 2 hours to teach us all about preterism, and they were uninterrupted, and we just listened and took notes. And I believe, Tanya, that you still have that up on your channel, don't you? Tanya?
I think so. I don't know if it might not be public anymore. I can't remember.
Okay. Well, it was up for a long time. But Tanya really was suffered because she was willing to have this doctrine of preterism on her channel, and she took a lot of heat from people that she was even associating with preterists. So that's how narrow-minded some people can be, that they don't even want to listen to people. So we gave Eve and Jerry a fair hearing. And then we did a second hangout with them, and in that hangout, they agreed to answer our questions. And what I did was I asked them probably 50 questions. See, if you don't know what preterism is, it's basically they believe that everything prophetic in the Bible has already been fulfilled. There is no unfulfilled prophecies. And that is even including the rapture and the resurrection. So they believe that there's no prophecy we have to look forward to. We are not looking forward to a rapture or a resurrection. So that's what preterism is. And I asked them about 50 questions, basically trying to learn. And basically I just went through the scriptures and said, well, when did this prophecy get fulfilled? When did that prophecy get fulfilled? And they gave us their answers. And I tried to be open-minded and listen. And then my conclusion at the end was, I said, look, I think what you've done is you've kind of like done contortions and you've tried to your best to answer these questions, but your answers in almost every case was so greatly lacking that I'm not even close to being persuaded. It just seems ridiculous. So that was my conclusion. And the reason I bring this up is Eve wanted to be here tonight discussing preterism effect and the Book of James. Mm-hmm. And I know that Tanya and Eve did that last night for 4 hours. So if you want to know a preterism viewpoint on the Book of James, then you can go watch it. It's on your channel, right, Tanya?
Actually, no. I took it down because the whole Hangout was a complete disaster.
All right. So. Okay. Well, the point is, Eve did have her opportunity to explain to everybody how she sees preterism in the Book of James. So she did have a chance to do that. It's just that I didn't want to go any further with that.
Well, wasn't what the Hangout was about. That wasn't the intention, and that's not what it was. Her and I were just reading through the whole Book of James together and studying it out together, like on a live Hangout.
Well, I know it wasn't the subject, it wasn't the theme of it, but she did discuss all of it, and she put a preterist take on it.
When she was talking about her parts,
that's what I mean. She got the chance to interpret James through the viewpoint of a preterist. So that's done. So I told her I didn't want to do that tonight. Now, getting back to this main point here that I'm trying to make is that I believe that I've been really fair over the years hearing people out, and in some cases I've changed my mind, and in other cases like preterism, and another example is oneness. I had long talks with oneness modalists. I learned a lot about it, but I was never persuaded, and I still hold to the Trinitarian position. But my point is that personally, I've been willing to hear out other people, and sometimes I change my mind, and sometimes I don't. But I want to give everybody every doctrine a fair hearing, and I think everybody should do that. But I still think that the wise thing to do is don't depart from orthodoxy very quickly. So that's my advice to everybody. Now, getting to my summary on this Book of James question, I think that we have a few choices. We could look at the Book of James and say, one choice is, let's remove it from the Scriptures. Some people have misunderstood what I've said and what Brother Mitch has said, and they think that we want it removed. You know, when the canon was put together, there was a great debate as to what was going to be in and what wouldn't, and the Book of James was very controversial, and it got in by the skin of its teeth. So historically, it's been very divisive whether it should be in the canon or not. But it is in. And then when Martin Luther started printing the Bible, he felt so strongly that James was contradicting Paul and it shouldn't be in Scripture, but he wasn't willing to take it out, but he did put a divider in front of it because he wanted to make the point that he was challenging its real canonicity. So one thing you could do is you could get rid of it. And if a person wants to reject it entirely, say it shouldn't be there, that's an option you have. Another option is the option that I've taken over the years, and that is try to interpret it and make it conform to the doctrine of salvation that we believe through faith alone. And I've spent many, many years coming up with some pretty good answers to explain away all these problem texts. But one thing I learned from my talk with Eve and Jerry, Tanya, when we heard them trying to explain preterism, and I had asked them all these questions, and I saw how convoluted the answers were and how ridiculous it sounded to me. It made me rethink also, maybe my answers trying to explain away some of these verses in James are so convoluted too that it just, I just felt like embarrassed that I've actually done that. So, but that's one thing. I mean, everybody on the panel is capable of taking any problem text in James, and you can try to interpret it in a way that it does not conflict. But I think these explanations are, like as Brother Mitch says, we're just trying to put a square peg in a round hole. So that's an option, and you're welcome to do that if that's your preference. Then we've got another option I clicked on the wrong one here. The other option is the hyperdees position. The hyperdees say that James, it should be in Scripture. But the message in James is not the message for salvation for us, for the church. They say that James has a message for salvation just for Jews. It's called the Gospel of the Kingdom. And in other words, they believe that people get saved two different ways. We in the church get saved through faith alone in Christ alone. And the Jews, they get saved through some kind of works in Judaism and the return when Jesus sets up his kingdom. So that's an option if you want to be a hyper-dispensationalist, but I believe that there's one way we all get saved. There's no difference between Jew and Gentile. There's one gospel, one faith, one baptism, one message for salvation. And so I think that the hyperdees is a ridiculous answer to the problem. And then finally, there's the answer that I gave based upon my talk with Brother Mitch for the last couple of years, and that you can find in the last video, and that basically is that we think that when Paul was talking about the foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you, you believed another gospel, it's not another, and Judaizers came into the church and brought Judaism in. I think we proved step by step how that happened, and James and these Jewish believers are the culprits. So that to me is the proper explanation for the book of James. Now, I've talked quite a long time, more than I wanted to in the beginning, but I wanted to get that all straight and just say, look, if you want to hold any of those positions, it doesn't bother me at all. If you want to try to interpret the verses and make them work, okay, I did that for years. I just don't think that's the right answer now. If you want to just tear it out and throw it away, I don't care about that either. You can decide what is the best answer for you. Okay? So now I'm going to ask each person one by one to just comment on anything they want to say about James briefly, and then we're going to move on to these other verses apart from James that we need to explain.
Well, I would definitely like to respond to that. Eve was going, she wasn't even going to come in here tonight. So that's one thing. I know that she had discussed a little bit with you about the James situation. And, you know, honestly, I don't really feel comfortable talking about her like that with her.
Well, this
here,
is public, so. Tonya. She can watch this. I'm not talking behind her back. We're live. I didn't say.
Well, I know.
I'm not saying anything about Eve that I didn't say in my email to her. I told Eve I did not want to bring preterism into the conversation on James.
Okay.
Okay.
That, I mean, that's your choice. This is your show. But for me personally, you know, when I first heard of the James thing, when we were talking about it, I think that I jumped a little bit too soon on the bandwagon, and which I do that, and you know I do that, Luke. I've done that many times before. I know. I've been that way since I was 17 years old. And so now I'm kind of, because this has been stressing me out, okay? It just has, ever since this started. At first I was excited because I was like, oh, okay, this explains a lot then. But then as I step back a little bit and I think about it more and I read more of what Paul said and everything, I've decided to slow down. I'm not going to make any kind of final decision yet. I'm just going to slow down, read this myself. We're not supposed to lean on our own understanding and to say, oh, well, since that one verse in James says that you're justified by works, we should just discredit everything James said. I'm not quite ready to do that, I don't think, yet. Because I believe that would be leaning on my own understanding. My own understanding is telling me, okay, I must throw out what James said because of that one verse. And so that's why I'm going to slow down a little bit, study it out, myself, and it's going to take a while, I'm sure.
So. Well, let me say that I hate to interrupt, but I think that you're exaggerating when you say there's one problem verse. There's a lot of problem verses in James. In the video I made last night, I took quite a few of his verses and compared them like Paul and James were having an argument. So there's a lot more than just one verse to deal with, okay?
Well, I'm talking about for me personally. Me personally, there's only one verse in that whole book that's a problem for me, and that was the one about being justified by your works. And so for me, all the other verses, I don't find a problem with those. I don't think that they're speaking about salvation. This is my opinion. So, you know, whatever anybody else thinks, that's on them. But for me, it was just that one verse. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thanks. Wait a second here.
Yay.
thank you, Tanya. And let me see. We got... I'm sorry. We got... okay. Now we got Austin.
Hey guys, I don't really have anything to add on the Book of James, because I think we got that squared away.
Okay, you don't want to express any opinion as far as the various options that I laid out. I said here's four or five different ways that you could look at it, and you want to express which one you.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. I think it's pretty clear that over the conversation, over our hangouts that we've done and the thorough study that we've come to the conclusion, regardless on your, I'm not directing this to you, you can just in general, regarding your view on the Book of James, that we can very well know that salvation is faith alone, and that just interpreting whether you believe the Book of James should be there, or shouldn't be there, or verses should be taken out, we can come to the conclusion over and over and over again that it's faith alone, saved by faith, by grace. Even Jesus, you know, the only time Jesus ever mentioned worked was when the apostles asked him, what is a work of God? And Jesus said, this is the work of God, that you believe upon his son whom he sent, in John 6:29. So, I mean, over and over and over, we know it's faith alone. And anybody that wants to debate that is literally just trying to super buff the Book of James to make it not say that. So I mean, I it's thorough, the conclusion that's faith alone.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Austin. And Brother Joseph.
Yeah, this is quite a hornet's nest when we threw a rock at this book. You know, I'm pretty close to what Tanya said. I'm not ready to disregard. I'm not ready to say it shouldn't have been in the canon, because just through church tradition, this book has stood with the rest of the Bible since the beginning, and so I choose to kind of have a similar view to what you said, Brother Luke, in that it's there to teach us historically the differences. At the beginning of the church age, and I think if it was inspired to be put into the Word of God, it was to teach us historicity rather than doctrine.
Yeah. Thank you. And Eric.
I want to engage a little bit what Joseph and Tanya were saying. Over my years as a Christian, one of the things I've learned is it is always a valuable quality as a Christian to be cautious. We're supposed to be stewards of the Word of God, and part of that is being cautious with the Word of God and how we treat it. If your feeling is that you're not sure, it's always a good thing to say, look, I'm just not sure. There's nothing wrong with that. It may take a little more time for you to kind of build a stand on it. So that's actually a good way to be. I mean, you shouldn't be hasty or rash when you make a decision. If you feel like you don't have enough information, that's always the right way to go by it. And that goes for anybody who may be debating this issue. But I will say at the same time, it is a question that I can tell you is going to be an issue in your walk. So it's not something that you can just kind of put on the back burner and say, I'm not going to deal with it. It's got to be something that you do need to study, you do need to go into, because this is an idea that's really prevalent out there. It's being pushed, and you know, we need to be able to give an account of why we believe what we believe. So it's something that it's great to be cautious, and I think that's a wise thing to do. If both Joseph and Tanya feel that way, and even I am not quite sure about everything. I know pretty much how I stand on it, I think, but I think it's always good to be cautious, but realize that, you know, it's one of those things. I don't think you can really afford to be stationary. You really have to develop this, because it is going to come up, and you are going to have to engage in discussion with this.
Mm-hmm. Well, I forgot to give applause for my opening statement. I think the point you made there, Brother Eric, is a very important to keep in mind, and that is that none of us can escape having to deal with James, because James is the book for all the works lordship salvationists. Every Mormon, Roman Catholic theology, that's all they care about. They just want to quote James.
Yeah.
So you're gonna have to try. You're gonna have to answer them one way or the other. You know. And as I said, Brother Mitch, he knows all the answers that we know. I know all the answers that you guys know as far as trying to explain them away. I just have come to a different conclusion. I didn't come to it quickly. Probably 2 years I've been discussing this with Mitch. So I'm not pressuring anybody to agree with Mitch or me on this. If you take your time, I think that's wise. But I've already been through this whole process trying to dispute it. I tried to dispute with Mitch for a long time, and I'm just now I'm with him on it. Okay.
Hey, Brother Luke, I did have a question.
Yeah.
Since you supported the Book of James, right, back in the day when you debated with Mitch?
Yeah, yeah.
How did you make it sound? How did you word it? Because everybody knows you've always been a faith alone guy. How did you make the Book of James work with the faith alone doctrine?
Well, first I had to ignore the fact that it was not really it was not a message. I had to say this is not a message about salvation at all.
Okay.
And I compared. I said Paul, his life ministry was evangelism. James' life ministry was a pastor. Paul traveled all over the world telling the good news and open up churches, and his job was to bring people into this new birth. And then he'd leave, and he'd send some letters, but he'd leave a pastor there. He was not the pastor on the staff. James never left Jerusalem. He was not an evangelist. So he had a congregation of believers. He didn't need to talk to them about whether they, you know, how to get saved. That should have already been settled with them. His job as a pastor was try to help them grow and mature and do good works and be productive Christians. So that's the answer. That's the approach that I've taken over the overall take of the book before.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, that's a good question. All right, we're going to move on now, unless anyone else wants to say anything before I do. Okay, I've got a lot of questions that have come to me over the last few weeks asking, well, on your show, could you discuss this or discuss that? Last time I kind of lumped together a lot of verses that I call the impossible verses, remember? I said, Jesus said, go and be perfect. He said, cut off your hand, if gouge out your eye, if it causes you to sin, sell everything you own. And his apostles said, well, how is it possible for anyone to be saved? And Jesus, it's impossible. That's why you need God to save you, you know. So I lumped all of those verses into this category of the impossible sayings of Jesus, okay? So now, apart from those verses, there's still plenty of others. Does anybody have one in mind that you want to bring up, apart from the impossible ones and apart from the James sayings? I've got a bunch in mind, but I don't want to necessarily bring mine unless I have to.
Yeah, I posted one in the chat here, and I'll just read it. This is Romans 2:13. It says, for not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified.
That's a James verse, right?
No, that's Romans 2:13.
Oh, the doers of the law. Okay, I guess anybody want to take a stab at that?
I can explain what the law is, at least. I'll lay that. Back in the day, the law consisted of a bunch of different ordinances that the Jewish people had to follow. And forgive me, I'm not exactly sure, but I think it was a hefty number in the 612 Masonic laws. And we know that in the New Testament, after Christ's passing, the law was fulfilled into one word. In Galatians 5:14, it says, "The law is fulfilled in one word, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." So the new law that it's pertaining to in this sense would be to love thy neighbor as thyself. So I'm thinking that on this type of verse, I'm going to say it's relating to a love, type of love.
I agree, and we got to talk about James. I'm sorry, but because that's exactly what James says as well. And when I was looking through the book of James, I mean, I've been reading it like crazy, guys, the past few days. Everything that James talks about is talking about loving people, showing your love towards people. And so I don't see that contradicting with what Paul said right here in Romans 2:13. So what do y'all think about that?
I'd chime in, Tanya, that is an easy way out. What Austin had said by saying being a doer of the law, well, now the law is just one commandment, and it sounds to me almost a little bit too trite.
Well, I know, but if he's right, and it is speaking of, you know, loving people, then there's no contradictions then.
I do remember what you're saying, Galaxy, because I remember in James there's a verse where he says, what good does it do if you see somebody that needs help and you don't help them, and or if you...
Yeah, what doeth it profit,
right,
if you don't give them the food and the clothes if they're naked and hungry.
Well, I can see one mistake we're making right now. Anybody want to say what I think it is?
I would say, I don't know what you're referring to, quite honestly, Brother Luke, but I did want to say prior to you revealing that when in Romans, I'm a little foggy. I kind of think that being a doer of the law kind of consists of the Mosaic law. It's what it sounds like to me.
I'm going to say this, and this might be a possibility, is that this seems to be one of those cases where we're talking about the wrong kind of justification. I think here they're talking about justification before men and God, in that if you look at the rest of the context in Romans that you read, it seems to be speaking a lot about obedience to the law, and that there's no respect of persons. Verse 11 is, for there is no respect of persons with God, and this may be how he deals with people as they sin. So we could be talking about the results of sin, like we talked about in your life, like people who say, well, you're telling people they can get away with sin. Well, no, you don't get away. You can't get away with sin. There are going to be repercussions. Judgment is going to come on you in certain ways. In God's way for you as the believer, you're going to he's going to have to discipline you in certain ways. Maybe it's a stretch, maybe I'm wrong, but it's possible that that's what they're talking about. It's a different kind of justification, not salvation justification.
Well, with that said, James chapter 2, the whole chapter is discussing, well, all the whole book of James is talking about not being a respecter of persons. And like you said, that's in Romans 2:11. So to me, when I read Romans 2, okay, the whole chapter, I saw what Paul was saying in that chapter pretty much matched up with what James was saying.
Really?
Let me for the record profess that I wouldn't try to make any conclusions, Bro Luke. I was just interpreting what I thought it meant. I'm not saying that was what is set in stone. I was just guessing.
You talk to me, because I was gone for like 30 seconds. I lost the connection. I had to get back on. So I don't know what you said.
I was just saying for the record. I wasn't trying to make any conclusions about that verse. I was just taking a stab at it because I didn't know exactly how it was referring to in that sense.
Yeah, well, I didn't hear what you said about it. So what was your point you made on it? Because I missed that.
I just said that I wasn't making any solid conclusions on it. I was just taking a stab at it because you said there was a mistake out there, and I didn't know exactly how you wanted to word that.
He was making the point that the law is complete in the commandment that we love one another.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Well, the point I was going to bring up is that haven't we failed to get context here? I don't even know the context, so I think that's the first thing you've got to do, isn't it?
Tanya had thoroughly read the entire chapter and related it to justifying James the Just.
Well, but if you read
the chapter in like 20 seconds, I was gone.
No, studied it last night.
You just previously.
Well, what about for us? For us, don't you think we should be taking it in context and looking at it ourselves?
I think so.
Yes.
Okay. I was saying that I was saying that Romans 2, when I read all of Romans 2, seemed to match up perfectly with all of the book of James.
Okay.
You know, talking about not being a respecter of persons, being doers of the law, not hearers only. I mean, that's all in Romans 2 also.
Okay, so Tanya, your turn. Explain the verse then.
Which one?
The one you brought up as a problem verse. What's your explanation? What does it mean?
I believe pretty much what Austin was saying. I think that it's speaking of loving people, loving your neighbor, and showing love in that way.
Can I just add something real fast? I just wanted to mention, because I remember that people, it's a good question. It was asked to Jesus, and he gave a parable, I believe, of it. And that's where we get the old saying, the Good Samaritan. And somebody asked Jesus, how do we love our neighbor? What's loving our neighbor? And Jesus gave an example. It might have been a parable, forgive me, I don't know the name of it, but it was with a priest, a rich man, and a Samaritan. And anyway, this man is either got sick or he got in an accident and he needed some help. And I remember the priest, he kind of did like how James explained it. He just kind of prayed for him and went his way. You know, he could have did something, but he didn't. And then there's the rich man and he left him. But the Samaritan, I think, was the enemy of this man's tribe, but the Samaritan helped him. And Jesus was explaining, you know, I love thy neighbor as thyself. He was meaning it. It sounded to me. Now, I'm not trying to make any conclusive statements. I'm just saying it, how it sounded to me was to love thy neighbor as thyself. Love the ones that we all know that God loved everybody. But I'm just how he worded it. Christ. It sounded like Christ was saying to love thy ones that do something to help you out. And, you know, your enemies, to love your enemies also, but in this context, it just sounded so deep, like he was saying, to love thy neighbor in a sense of the ones that will be there to help you no matter what, and to love your enemies just in the same regard.
Okay, anybody else want to go on that? Because I just posted another one you might want to discuss.
Well, yeah, I want to go back to what this Romans issue with Romans 2:13, and this is where context does not just apply to a chapter; it applies to the whole book. So, if you go, and this is the way Paul traditionally writes, and this is where I've caught people in a few things like this because they seem to come across something that's confusing to them, because they'll kind of catch Paul's message halfway through the book he's writing, and they got to consider how he starts the message. If you go back in chapter 1, one of the first things Paul does in chapter 1, he establishes in verse 16, before he goes into this whole thing, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." I think what he does then is he goes on to engage the fact that at that time they were holding people to the law. They were telling them about justification by their works. They were holding them to the law, and he begins to go down. And what he seems to be doing from 1 to 2 and 3 is kind of going down the line and telling them essentially, well, you need to watch what you're saying, because there's verses in there where he's saying, you are saying not to do these things, and you do them yourselves. He's kind of holding their feet to the fire for what they're saying. He's saying, you want to say that this is about works, you want to say it's about this, okay, well, I'll entertain that thought, and I'm going to hold you to the fire, and I'm going to measure you by what you're saying. Are you violating the things you're telling these people to do? And they were. If you go through the process of the rest of the chapter...
I'm sorry. When you stopped, I thought you were finished.
It's good. Were you happy I was done, or...?
No, I'm just trying to play with this, and I thought, oh, he stopped.
No, that's fine. Go ahead.
But that's what I was asking for, someone to provide some context. And you're right. You have the context of the preceding and following verses. You have the context of the chapter. You have the context of the scriptures as a whole. And everything, and it has to fit all those contexts. You have to look at all those contexts to see, to really get a full understanding of it. Okay. Well, want to move to the next one, or you need to talk about that anymore?
I just want to say I very much appreciate that commentary, Eric. That was very helpful to me.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Okay. All right. I wanted to lighten up a little bit. Okay. Let me see. Did you see the next one I posted? Romans 8:1. Says there is now no condemnation to them which are in Christ, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. This is the verse someone sent me to explain. So, what do you think?
Yeah, that was a tough one for me too. I remember, because then you're like, well, if you're walking after the flesh, then you're sinning, which we do sin. So if you're walking after the Spirit, then you're not sinning, but we do sin. So what's that mean? So.
Well, real quick, I have a question, Luke. Now, you say you're posting these things. Where are they popping up? Because I'm not getting them. I don't see where. Okay. Is it in the chat? Or the?
Yeah, it's in the chat section. I just posted it.
So if I just click that, it'll open up. And.
Yeah, you have to. You know how to get to your chat section?
No.
On the left-hand column, the top left one, it has a blue box with white lines across it.
Right.
If you click left-click on that, and it should pull up the chat on the right side.
Yeah, no, nah, it's not coming up. Oh, there we go. Oh, it's magic. All right, there we go.
Okay. All right, so that's where it's posted. So I can either keep my chat up, or I can keep my special effects up. I think I'll go with the special effects. All right, so go ahead. Take a stab at this, guys.
Luke, I just found something I did want to mention with the law. Is that okay if I throw it out real fast?
Yeah, sure.
It's two verses, and they explain why it's there. And I remember this. It's a good study. This is Romans 3:20. So this is Romans. And this is after that. What is it? Romans 2:11. So this is after that, and it precedes it. It says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for the law is the knowledge of sin. And then Galatians 3:19 says, wherefore then serveth the law? It was added because of transgressions, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, and it was ordained by angels in the hand of the mediator. How I view this is the law is only there to show that we've broken it, and now we need a Savior, because since we, you know, the law stands for a perfect obedience. If we've broken that, it means we've fallen from perfect, and that means we need someone that was perfect, Jesus, to save us for that. And I just wanted to throw it out there, that the deeds of the law, no flesh shall be justified. It is just the knowledge of sin. It's to know that we've broken it, and now we need a Savior who's perfect, and that was Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, remember what I recapped at the beginning. In the very first episode, we laid down the foundation that I think was solid proof that there's dozens of clear verses like that. We went over quite a few of them, And these verses do not require any kind of interpretation or explanation. They just clearly say, you're saved by faith with no works required in various ways. They just say it over and over again. So, yeah, that's the foundation, and that's what we know. Now what we're asking is the other verses that we're discovering that people say, well, what about this verse? It seems to contradict that. Well, let's take them. We're taking them one at a time. And who else wants to talk about that verse?
I do. I just looked up the word.
Oh, you were too quick. I thought you guys were going to like be slow to.
We're on top of it now. Now that you've figured out how to use the effects, of course, we're going to be quick now. See? okay, so I looked up the word to walk or who walk in that verse. There is no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit. To me, that part, who walk, it's important to know, what does that mean? So I looked it up, and it means, and let me just tell you for the audience, it is Strong's G4043, and that word means to make one's way, progress, to make due use of opportunities. So that makes sense. So that verse isn't saying people who, you know, don't sin. It's just saying people who are saved make good use of the opportunities of the Spirit, because we're more spiritual now, I guess.
Well, I think that's a good comment, Tanya, and I think, and you know, we often have been talking here about, well, no, you know, we're not saved by our works. We can't be unsaved. We can't delay those things. But, you know, you got to go out there and talk to some of these Christians and say, you know, Christians, you guys are part of the problem here. Because if you did walk after the Spirit like you're supposed to, we wouldn't have to answer a lot of these questions, because you wouldn't look so bad to the rest of the world. Now, does that mean they're not saved? No, it doesn't mean they're not saved. But they're not in their walk as they should be. I mean, they should be trying to walk closer to God, learn each day, grow in Christ, which is Paul's complaint to the Galatians, that he said that he could not give them meat, he could only give them milk. It was either them or the Corinthians. But he said he wanted to give them meat. He wanted to give them the higher things to learn, but they couldn't get past being the carnal. That's why I believe it was the Corinthians, because they were being carnal. And they couldn't get past that. They weren't even growing past the very basic things that they should be promoting as Christians, you know. So I think you do have to kind of come back and say, Christians, look, you know, you do need to try to kind of be a better influence. I mean, isn't that our whole point in being here? I mean, it's, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And if I could just say this real quick, I think a lot of it is, you know, because most of us have struggled with legalism, you know, feeling like dog crap, you know, because we're not these, you know, perfect little cookie cutter Christians who do all this great stuff, whatever. We own up to the fact that we do sin daily. I mean, every day there's something we do that's not right, okay? And I think that a lot of it has to do with a couple of things. In society, human nature, whatever, we are raised and taught that, like, if you work hard, you'll reap the benefits of that, okay? And that's in every aspect of our life. It just is, okay? I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I'm just saying that is probably one of the reasons that people have a hard time accepting the fact that I really don't have to do anything to get God to love me. So there's that. And then there is this misconception that the Jews were saved because of their works. And that's not the way it was. And that's the one thing that Eve and I were talking about last night, is that a lot of people think that in the Old Testament it teaches that they followed the law to be saved. And that's not the case. They followed the law because of two reasons. Because they were promised that they would be blessed and that they would gain entrance into the promised land. That's it. Had nothing to do with escaping Hades or hell or anything. And the mainstream Christian church doesn't teach that. They teach that, oh, the Jews had to do their sacrifices so that they could go to heaven. So it's a whole lot of misunderstanding, and it really is. And that is us leaning on our own understanding. We're using our own logic to explain it, and we shouldn't be doing that. We should read. It takes a lot of studying to figure this out, because this isn't what the main mainstream preachers teach. They teach the wrong thing. They got it wrong. So now we got to work extra hard and read this big Bible to figure this out for ourselves.
Okay, if you were to go back and watch the series that we did a month or two ago called Old Testament Pictures and Shadows of Jesus' Blood Atonement. Hey, brother.
Hi, hey, brother. Mitch.
Hey, Mitch.
Hello. Nice to see you here. I will let you introduce yourself as soon as I make this point here. I was just in the middle of a sentence.
All right.
We did this series, the Old Testament Pictures and Shadows of Jesus' Blood Atonement, and I think there's four or five episodes that are 2 hours long. So it's very thorough, showing that all through the Old Testament, their faith was in a blood sacrifice to come. And we went into great detail explaining that, yeah, the reason the Jews had their laws was not for salvation. It was for blessings, the lives to be blessed, and also for them to get into the promised land. So I agree that that's the right point there. Let me introduce Brother Mitch, and then I want to ask you about the verse we're talking about, a particular word, okay? Hey, Brother Mitch, glad you could join us. You've missed a little bit, but nothing much. We're just starting to go through some of these verses to explain how we could be saved through faith alone in light of this verse that we're looking at. Say hi to everybody. Uh-oh, did he go?
Bro Mitch left.
Oh, well, hopefully he'll be back.
I'm sure okay. He'll be back.
All right. Maybe I talk so much, I just talked him right off the show.
You know what it was? You should have given him applause when he came in. Then I bet he would have stayed.
Next time he comes back, I'm going to give him applause.
Yeah, get it ready.
Okay.
Real quick, one of the things Tanya was saying, and people didn't even think about this in the Old Testament when they talked about as far as being righteous in front of God and being forgiven for their sins. Even back then, God established the blood sacrifices on their behalf. He didn't set apart people and said, now these people who are perfect, who didn't ever do this, they don't have to worry about any of this. There wasn't a group of people like that in the Old Testament. The whole nation had to rely on sacrifices that were made on behalf of the nation for their sins of the nation. So the sacrifices still had to cover the sins of the nation. They still weren't people living at that time perfect. David wasn't perfect. Abraham wasn't perfect. In fact, they did things in their prime when God was calling David the apple of his eye. Here he's doing what he's doing with Bathsheba. So it wasn't like these were perfect people. There were no perfect people then.
Except for Enoch.
Enoch was pretty good.
Yeah. Enoch is the only one where it doesn't say anything bad, only good stuff.
Yeah, he was.
Brother Mitch, are you there?
Yeah, I'm back. Thank you. Hey. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
We're so happy you're
so
with us.
So glad you're here, man.
We thought he was with us, and then I wouldn't stop talking, so he left. Okay, everybody knows Brother Mitch, but Mitch, just because for the world, anybody else who might watch this who doesn't know you besides the panelists, introduce yourself, okay?
Hi, I'm Mitch.
Hi, Mitch.
He's not Mitch, he's Brother Mitch.
Yeah.
Okay, do you see the verse I put up there that there's a one word in that verse. Mitch, if you know how to go to the comment section and see the verse I posted in the comment, someone read it, and then I want to stop on a particular word.
If he's using his iPad, he's not going to be able to see the comments.
Okay, let's read the verse then so he can hear it.
Sure.
Is it Romans 8:1? Is that what we're reading?
Yeah.
Okay. There is no condemnation.
Wait, what? There's no what?
Condemnation.
Condemnation? That's the word, huh? Okay, keep that in mind. Go ahead.
There is now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit.
Okay, So far, people have been explaining this verse, but I'd like to see if anybody can explain it, focusing on what this condemnation is. Obviously, everybody always assumes that salvation and fire and condemnation, they are all, it always has the same meaning. So tell me what you think condemnation is in this context.
The shoot from the hip answer is damnation.
Well, that's the shoot from the hip, but that's not what I'm asking for. I'm asking for some thought.
Okay. Actually, in the Greek, it's judgment.
Okay.
The Greek word here is actually judgment.
Is it talking about going to hell?
It's saying you won't go to hell.
Did you just say go to hell?
Yeah.
All right.
Now, is this verse talking
there, I'll
about,
come back.
is this verse talking about, see, let's not just automatically say there is no condemnation for this person. Well, are we talking about being condemned into hell? Let's figure that out.
That's the common understanding in about 80% of the churches.
Well, brother, that's why I'm asking the question. You cannot just take a word and assume it always has the immediate meaning. It may not have that meaning.
I wasn't trying to advocate that position, Luke. I was merely saying what most people think.
Right.
Okay.
Right. I think what he's talking about here is condemnation under the law. Because in the very next verse, he's talking about, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. Well, there's no condemnation for us under the law. We can't be condemned by the law.
Well, yeah, and it can't be talking about anything physical, because people who believe in Christ are physically condemned every day. So, you know, it has to be talked about something besides, like, physical condemnation, I would think.
Well, I'm not sure what a physical condemnation is. You mean just talking about, like, getting sick or dying or something?
Well, like, you know, persecution or physical
and actually, you're
judgment.
Talking about being an actual physical judgment, like locked up in prison for breaking a law or something. That, you know,
or
something.
Even stoned or something.
Oh, right. Then. Right.
Even that, we can go there.
Can I ask Brother Mitch, since he's late to the show here anyway, if we give him a chance to, if he has any ideas on this verse, read the verse to him one more time, someone.
Romans 8:1. There is now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit.
Well, first of all, in that verse, I believe there's a therefore, usually. And what it's there for is basically pertaining to Romans chapter 7 here. And the word is judgment, being judged under the law.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to take it back to Romans chapter 7 and talk about, well, and also walk by the Spirit, what that means. Well, walking by the Spirit means that you've been released from the power of the law. If we go back to 7, what's it, 4, it says, so my brothers and sisters, you also died to the law through the body of Christ, that you might belong to another. This is the Spirit that makes you alive to this. To him who was raised from the dead, in order that we might bear fruit for God. For when we were in the realm of the flesh, remember walking by the flesh, and the sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in us. So when the law was in us, it actually aroused sinful passion.
Mm-hmm.
So when we were walking by our flesh, by the law, or not under the salvation of Christ that removes that what causes the sinful flesh to become aroused, what was working, we become free. And so there's no condemnation within us, because the law has been removed from us. The sinful passions that were aroused by the law are now in check. So when you walk by the Spirit, you don't gratify the sinful nature. So basically, when we walk by the Spirit, we're no longer judged, because the Spirit testifies of Christ, which took our judgment away. Now, as far as hell and damnation,
right.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, good. That's good. I was done. It's okay. Oh,
okay. I thought you were done, but then, but so the point of this is that some people have sent us verses to explain, and they send us a verse because they think this verse somehow debunks our viewpoint that faith is the only requirement. No works are required. So when they said to those who walk after the Spirit, not after the flesh, in other words, they're trying to make it seem like, well, if someone is walking by the flesh, then they are condemned, is what their take on it.
Well, that whole word there, you see, this was the confusing part between what the word flesh means. The word flesh means is walking by our own ability to please God and not under the Spirit that took our sins away. When we walk by the flesh, that means we're trying to get to heaven by our own power.
Right. So
we don't have Christ's blood over the top of us.
Exactly. And I think this what comes to the explanation. Walking after the Spirit is walking in faith.
It's walking in the blood.
Yes, faith in what Christ
anymore.
Right. Right. Trying to walk under the flesh is also part of trying to live according to the law to earn your way to salvation or to work your way to salvation. That's also part of living under the flesh. And you can't do it. You can't hope to do that. You're by your sin nature in your flesh, you're going to fail. You're going to fail.
Chapter 7 absolutely, that's what chapter 7 was all about. For Paul said, I don't know what I'm doing. I wind up doing what I don't want to do. Okay, this was because he was under the law. He wasn't talking about his condition when he became in Christ Jesus. He was talking about a condition when he was like a Pharisee. Like he was walking in the flesh and he kept on doing what he didn't want to do because his sinful passions were aroused within him. That doesn't mean we stopped sinning. But the thing is that he was in that mill of trying to not gratify the sinful nature but doing it anyway. So walking by the flesh causes you to gratify the sinful nature. Romans 6:14 says, "We are the what is it? Sin shall no longer have a dominion over you, for you because you are no longer under the law."
But this is a little bit what I talked about. When you go back to that verse, Paul, and this is why I want to keep this in context of what he's saying, Paul is not saying even that was something that used to be, and that was in the letter I wrote to Luke. He's saying, I do these things in the present tense. He's saying, I still wrestle with that side of me.
I have to disagree with that, because it's not actually that it's in the present tense. He's talking in the prison tense in the past.
But that I don't see that.
Okay, well then let's go over Romans 7 completely and I'll show it to you.
I've read it
50 times. And I was confused by it also. No, he's talking about a condition before salvation.
Let me ask this. I'm not seeing it anymore.
There it is. I would not have known sin had it not been for the law, for I would have not known coveting was real, really was until the law had said, thou shalt not covet. But seizing the opportunity afforded by the commandment produced in me every time every kind of coveting was in me. In other words, apart from the law, sin was dead. But once the law came, I was made alive. But when the commandment came, sin sprang to life and I died. I found that the very commandment that was intended to bring life actually brought death, for sin, seizing the opportunity afforded by the commandment, deceived me, and I died. It goes on. But
it does, well, wait a minute. Now, here's what I'm talking about. But in verse 17, he changes gears. He says, now then, it is no more that I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. He keeps going down. He gets to verse 23. But I see another law in my members. He's saying, I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, not was. He's not saying I was this way. He's saying I still wrestle with these issues.
No. You see, what you're looking at here is you're looking at, yes, we still have the sinful nature in us, but since we're no longer under the law, they don't have dominion over us like it did before.
Right. No. Yes. That part of it, we have the ability through the Holy Spirit to overcome these things. Yes, that I agree with you. Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's what Paul was saying.
He still has this desire in him. People want to, and this is what I was writing to Luke about. People have this tendency of want to make you believe that Paul, once he was saved, he never did anything wrong anymore. He'd stop sinning.
Right. Well,
and he didn't.
Exactly. No. You're right on point.
Right.
But the thing here is that there's something even better than that. Because when I know that Christ took my sins away, and I know He loves me no matter what I do, all of a sudden, the sinful nature is like God. Because I'm praising, I'm thanking, I'm living in Him, I'm walking in Him, the joy of the Spirit's within me, and just because the law was taken away and I know I'm loved by the Holy Spirit, I'm all of a sudden walking by the Spirit and I'm not sinning. And so this is the victory that we have in Christ Jesus. Yes, we always have a sinful nature. I agree with you. Basically, if you start walking by the law and you see people doing this, the more you try to walk by the law, the more you keep on messing up. People try to walk by the law.
Yeah, absolutely.
Falling
absolutely.
On their face over and over again in this roller coaster ride. Oh, today I'm doing great. Oh, man, I'm so mad at this guy. Oh, God, you must hate me. And this is the up and down of Lordship Christianity. And the
Yes. Here
is walking in the Spirit, knowing that that all doesn't matter.
Yes.
You will live a life to God in such a way that it will be pleasing to Him, and though you may sin, it will be nothing like being mastered by it and having dominion over you.
Right.
Living by the law, trying to live by conditional love.
Right.
I would chime in, Mitch, that Eric does have a good point. Also, what you said is I couldn't agree more. But I think Eric has a good point too, because I remember another section of scripture where Paul says, I buffet my body daily because I'm so sick of this old man. So it was in real time that he's struggling.
But I see also where Mitch is going, because this idea of it, this rolls into the next chapter, which is saying, along the lines of what Mitch is saying, thank God I know I am not condemned by the law anymore. I don't have that hanging over my head. I don't have to worry about walking each day going, what law have I broken today that might have taken me out of heaven? Or, you know, you don't walk that way anymore. You walk in that newness of the Spirit that says, I'm not condemned by it. And by its nature, it makes you want to desire to do better. It gives you that. And we're told that Christ, the Holy Spirit in us, gives the ability. We have the ability to walk away from sins if we want to, any sin we want. You know, do we always do it? No, we don't. Sometimes we give into the flesh and we do those things. But it kind of...
My point in sticking up for you, Eric, which you obviously didn't appreciate, I do agree with Mitch, but I did want to point out that Paul, in real time, currently still suffered under the bondage of legalism in his own mind. He was not a perfect character, and he did. He said, I hate the old man, and he beat himself. That's pretty bad.
I'm glad you brought that up, Jay, because this kind of goes into what I've been wanting to ask you guys, because I got to pick your guys' brain while I got the chance, okay? So here's my question. Because Paul was struggling with that condemnation feeling a little bit, you know, like we all do. I mean, we do every day. Even we have peace in Christ now. Sometimes, let's be honest, it creeps in every once in a while, okay? All right. Mm-hmm. And then the Comforter helps us, and that's great. Now, here's my question. Back when Paul was around, okay, and remember that sect of believer Pharisees that we were talking about earlier. My question is, after Christ came and was resurrected and all of that stuff, and then you had the believer Pharisees, okay, were those Pharisees who were believers and the Jews who were still practicing some of the law, but they were believers in Christ, were they still condemning people who broke the law by stoning or any other way that they did it? That's what I want to know.
Well, they stoned Peter. They stoned Stephen to death.
Yeah, absolutely they did.
Well, right, but who stoned Stephen? Was it the Pharisee believers, or was it the Jews who rejected Christ that did that?
at the time, I would have said it was the Jews who were the Pharisees who were rejecting Christ. They reject because Paul at that time was with them, and he rejected Christianity at that point outright. He was holding the codes for those who were stoning Stephen. He was still known as Saul at that point. He hadn't converted. He hadn't changed. So I would say these are the Pharisees, yes, that did not believe in Christianity. Were trying to terminate Christianity.
But there was a sect that was trying to please both the new covenant and the old law. And
right.
Again, right back to James.
Right.
Right.
Exactly.
That's why I'm bringing this up, because I want to know if I know that they were trying to follow some of the law, even as far as, you know, telling the Gentiles, hey, you guys got to get circumcised, and then that was the big, you know, dispute between them. But I'm wondering if Paul is making the statement there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, if he's basically telling those Pharisees who are believers that, hey, you can't be condemning people for not following the law anymore.
Tonya, boy, I think I made a mistake in the beginning of the show saying everybody speak up and I want to take a back seat. I can't get a word in edgewise with this group tonight.
Sorry, Luke.
I think the example for your point, Tonya, is the fact that they wanted Paul dead. They were condemning Paul to death because he was saying you don't have to follow the law.
Even when it was the believer Pharisees who were doing
yes.
that.
Yes,
right.
It was. It was the believer Pharisees. That was the when Paul was there and they were saying, you're telling them they don't have to follow law. That was a group of believers. And you can watch the first show on James we did, and I walked you through that step by step. Getting back to, never mind, I don't want to interrupt for everybody going, so everybody made a lot of real good points. Anybody want to go on with this any further? I've got another verse. Actually, I wanted to give Mitch a chance to go back to the first verse since he missed that, if he's interested. And he right. probably has something to say about that. But I don't have it on my screen. I guess I lost everything, and then when I got back on, the comments have started.
Well, here's what I wanted to ask Mitch about, because I really want your opinion on this, Mitch. Okay, so this is Romans 2:13. And then I'm also going to read Romans 3:20. To me, it seems like this is a contradiction. I want your opinion on this. Okay, so Romans 2:13 says, "For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified." Okay, so that's Romans 2:13. But then in Romans 2:20, it says, "Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for the law is the knowledge of sin."
Right, well, that's exactly the point. You see, the first two chapters was telling you how Judaism can make it to heaven. But then he said there's a new way, apart from the law. See, basically, the first couple of chapters of Romans was telling you that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And it would agree with James now, wouldn't it? Because basically that's what James said. But the thing is that what he was talking about living under the law. And so if you go on in the chapter, you start to see how he just draws a distinction that there's no difference between Jew and Greek, and which also kills the whole point that James was talking to the Pharisees, and that was fine because that was before the Gentiles came in. It basically nails the idea that he was talking to the Pharisees, all right, the Pharisaical Christians that were persecuting the Gentiles. So actually, no, it doesn't contradict. It actually just is that the way Paul starts his argument off, he starts his argument proving that by the Jewish way, you can't get there from here. You can't get to heaven by the Jewish way.
Okay, so that was my thing. That was the part I was having trouble with because – So you're saying that the first part of Romans, chapter 1, chapter 2, he is agreeing with James because he's establishing that, and then in the rest of the book of Romans, he's going to show that how that's not correct. Is that
exactly
what you're saying?
Exactly. If you read along with it, that's the way it is.
I'd like to just look at a different facet. Not that I disagree with anything you said, Mitch, But you did say that the law you can get to heaven apart from the law, and I would disagree with that. I would say it's not apart from the law, but as a result of the fulfillment of the law, because the law is a good thing. The law was godly and just, and remains a good thing. David said, "I love your law, and I think of it daily. I think of it every moment." So I don't want to say we're not that it's as apart from the law. I would say as a fulfillment of the law, Christ took that bondage off us.
Well, according to Romans, the words were apart from the law. I was actually quoting scripture.
No, I know you were, Mitch. I'm just saying that what I did say to begin with is I agree with what you're saying, but I want to not ignore another facet of this.
Actually, that's all in Romans. If you read on, Paul does say that the law was good. I mean, if you just read the text, it's all right there.
Yeah, I think
I was just trying to illuminate the next part of the text that you just mentioned. It's a fulfillment of the law, and the law is good.
Yeah.
Yeah, the law was good, but this was the argument in Romans chapter 5. If the law was so good, then what was wrong with it? Well, I'm not so good, so it killed me.
Prior to Christ's sacrifice, the law was a necessary thing, and it was impossible to live up to. But the blood sacrifices were what kept the law under, I don't know how to, where I'm a little bit foggy today, I'm sorry. All I'm trying to say is Christ was a fulfillment of the law, and we don't despise the law, we embrace the law, but it's fulfilled in Christ.
Right, but the law was actually taken away from us. We were separated from the law by death.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
We were separated by the law from death.
Although, maybe you're missing what I was saying, but that's
okay. No, I'm not missing it at all. I'm agreeing with you that the law was good, but they had the law also had to do with the sacrifices, of course, because they couldn't follow it either. So basically, if you read on in the text, Paul even says that the law is good.
Right. And the Pharisees were continuing this blood sacrifices, and Paul was saying that you're actually crucifying Christ anew, saying his death was not the fulfillment. And
right. They were doing the sacrifices to fulfill the law when Christ fulfilled the law. So I see what you're saying. You're just saying that the law is good because, I mean, God is good. He's holy. We love God because he's holy. The law is great. We're just not under it anymore because it is fulfilled.
So many of the Lordship Salvation people criticize us, saying, "Well, you're lawless and you embrace sin rather than the law." And I would respond that no, we love the law and we seek to fulfill the law, but we cannot. And Christ did fulfill that, so we're no longer under its bondage, but we do recognize its purity.
I think I have to take exception with this emphasis on the law, because the Ten Commandments, the 613 laws, were given to Israel, and that was for Judaism. It was not given to the whole world. Even today, the Ten Commandments, we're not under that. We're under the law that Jesus gave us: love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And we're also, the law that the rest of the world had, apart from the Jews, was the law of the conscience. He wrote the law in our hearts. He gave us a conscience to know if we're doing right or wrong. So emphasizing that, like, we should, like, respect the law, the Ten Commandments, all that. No, Jesus, he replaced it with the two laws.
Well, I guess I would agree with that, Luke. I was just trying to think how the Lordship Salvationists are always attacking me, because I don't have any respect for the law, don't love the law, that kind of thing.
Here's
my typical response is what I just said. So maybe
there's one thing I wanted to add to what Joseph and Mitch were both saying, and this kind of ties with both of them were saying together, that they're both right in what they're saying. If you go up one more verse from the original verse we started talking to, Tanya was talking about in chapter 2, verse 13, where he first mentioned, "For not the hearers of the law." I'm starting to read this and go back, and remember I went back to chapter 1 and I said, if you establish, he establishes the faith premises in chapter 1. He establishes that. It looks like what Paul begins to do is he begins to set a foundation. He's talking about If you read through the rest of chapter 1 into chapter 2 up to that verse 13, it looks like he's building a foundation to describe the foundation of what the law is and that it is good, just like Joseph was saying. The law is good. It wasn't a bad thing. And he even he's talking about Gentiles and Jews. He gets to verse 12. He's saying, "For as many as have sinned without the law, Gentiles, shall also perish without the law." He's saying sin is sin, even for the people who aren't quote unquote under the law. If when the Gentiles perish, they're perishing in their sins as well. They're still in their sins. He's establishing the foundation for the law. Then he goes on later to say, "But we don't fall under this anymore." Yes, the establishing of that was true. Sin fell into the Gentiles as well. They have sins. Just because they aren't the followers of the law or the bringers of the law that the Jews were, they still die in their sins. They perish in their sins. So, yes, the law of God still applies. Then you get to verse 13. "For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law. For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, do by nature the things contained in the law," and they weren't under the law, "these, having not the law, are a law unto themselves." They still are establishing what is good and what is not good in the eyes of God that's written on the hearts of people in general, which is why God tells us also that people are without excuse.
Yeah, and if I could just take it a little further than that, because this goes back to one of the verses we were just talking about. The two laws that Jesus gave us, which is to love God and to love our neighbor, which we know reflects perfectly the Ten Commandments, because half of them were about loving God, the other half of them were about loving people. And those two laws fulfill the law, loving God, loving your neighbor. And that makes me go back and think about that verse we were talking about where we walk by the Spirit now, not by the flesh, because the difference is, because we have that Spirit in us, that perfect Spirit, we desire to love God and to love our neighbor. Whereas before, they were doing it more so for, like, obligation purposes. Did you see what I'm saying?
Okay, I did that because I'm about to speak.
That's a good way to announce yourself.
That'll be the sign. That's great.
Everybody shut up. Luke's going to talk.
Not that anything I have to say is more important than you guys, but that's the only way I can get a word in edgewise tonight. It's fun listening a lot, really. I want to back up to a point when everybody was talking about walking in the Spirit and what how Paul struggled with sin, and I think that it is not possible to completely stop sinning. The idea of sinless perfection, that we can decide one day that we're not going to ever sin again and then we're not going to. And we like to use Paul as an example that he continued to struggle with sin. And we have the verses that we discussed with Paul saying, "Why do I always do what I shouldn't do?" And then he also, the one that Job mentioned, might beat myself daily because of it. So we know that Paul's an example, and everybody struggles with it. But the idea of walking in the Spirit and not sinning, we certainly can do a lot better at sin. But part of it, there's a saying that I remember years ago I heard, if you are into the Bible, you're out of sin. If you're into sin, you're out of the Bible. You see, for some reason, as we study the Bible daily, it just strengthens us spiritually, and we're in the Spirit, and the desire and the temptation of sin is defeated. But on the other hand, if we're not in the Scriptures, once we get involved in sin, then we don't want to look at the Bible, because the Bible is going to convict us and of this sin. So they seem to go together. So the more we will pray, read the Scriptures, have fellowship, these things, then we're much more likely to sin less. Not be sinless, but to sin less. And once we neglect our Bible studies, our fellowship, and our prayer, then we're much more likely to start swimming in sin.
Yeah, that's exactly right, Brother Luke. As a matter of fact, I made a very short video a while back called "The Habitual Sins of the Believer," and I likened my problem with food. I keep walking past the fridge, and there's a piece of cake in there calling my name. And I finally give in and go pick it up. Well, if someone puts a little text on the top of the cake saying "contains rat poisoning," you know, I'm a lot less likely to take a bite. Well, that note on the top of the cake is the scripture.
Okay. I put up another verse, if you guys are ready to move on. But see, the thing about this group, we've got such a dynamic group here that, I mean, you could put up one verse and everybody can just be like expounding on it all night for 2 hours. But if you are willing, we can move on to another verse that someone sent me to discuss. And I put it up there. What was it? Wow, all these comments from Tanya here. Mine must be way up here. Oh, yeah, holiness. Let's look at Hebrews 3:1. Can someone find that? God, all these conversations going on in the text column here. Wow, you guys are busy. Okay.
Okay, I got it. Hebrews 3:1. Mm-hmm. Wherefore, holy brethren, partake... Oh, okay, I'll do that while I read it. Okay. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus. Here, I'll post it.
That's what it says?
Hebrews 3:1. Yeah.
Well, you must have given me the wrong one. I'm looking for the verse that says, without holiness, it is impossible to be saved. Or, so I don't, without holiness. Now
I know the verse you're talking about.
They sent me the wrong verse.
We went over that, Brother Luke. That was the verse I brought up last week that I even, we even went over in detail in it. It's Paul, it's John MacArthur's favorite verse.
Oh, Hebrews 12:14?
Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. Is that what you're getting at, Brother Luke?
Yeah, right. Okay. Okay, yeah, let's go to Matthew. That. Let's do Matthew 24:13 then. I forgot about that we covered that.
All right, Matthew 24:13.
Yeah.
Okay, that one says, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved.
All right, there you go. Can everybody understand why someone would send us that verse?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can cross-reference that with two more verses. Revelations 3:5 says exactly the same thing to the church at Sardis, I believe.
Yeah, and the Hyperdes, they explain that one away with that the Jews of that time were only saved if they endured to the end.
Well, I think one of the things is, I think that verse, he's talking about the tribulation. He's not talking about, which is a unique time.
Well, he's talking to the church at Sardis at the time, so it would be around 70 A.D.
When the
I mean the verse where you mentioned in Matthew when Jesus is speaking about the actual not the verse in Revelation, the one in Matthew. He's speaking about the tribulation.
Right.
Because if you notice, he goes down and he begins to talk about in 15, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation. He's speaking of the tribulation, which is a unique time period for anybody who becomes a believer at that time.
It's kind of funny, Eric. The one in Matthew is talking about the tribulation, and the one in Revelations is talking about the church in 70 A.D.
Right, Matthew 24, Luke 13, or Luke 21 and Mark 13 are all tribulation verses.
Right.
Okay, so now that you've established that this is talking about the tribulation, how does that answer the problem?
Well, because at that time, it's not assured for those people. And those people at the time, they could still, at that time, accept the mark. They can be condemned. They can give in. They have to endure through the time of testing, the tribulation.
That's an interesting thought, Eric. So salvation is different during the tribulation than for our church age?
Yes, I have come to believe that, yes. Because in our age, at the point where the believers dead in Christ and alive in Christ rise, and I believe most of you here, if not all of you, are pre-tribulationists for the rapture, that is the ending of that particular age for the church and the building of the church age. When the tribulation starts, it begins a time of testing on the earth. People who become believers at that time don't have that assurance. They have to endure to the end. The people who are going to clear that time, people have argued that point and said, no, people who go into the tribulation are going to be protected. Well, no, there's only certain groups in the tribulation which are clearly said are going to be protected. The two witnesses that are going to come forward and the 144,000 that are going to go out there are going to be protected. In fact, it says the Antichrist at that time is going to have authority over the Saints. He is going to make wage war against them and overcome them. So there is no sure thing for the Saints and the people who become Saints in the tribulation. That's going to be a time where they're going to have to endure because it's a time of testing, even for them.
A bit of a Revelations fanatic there, Eric. But go ahead, Brother Luke.
The idea you presented, Eric, it's a very common viewpoint. Some people believe that salvation was different before the cross, and now we have grace, and it's we're in this grace and faith alone dispensation, and then in the future it'll change, and there'll be faith plus enduring to the end, or not taking the mark of the beast. I know that there's two conditions in the tribulation that are cited. One is don't take the mark of the beast, and also the sheep and the goats are separated by how they dealt with the Jews.
Right.
Did they help the Jews or not? So what you're saying is there's a large group of people that would support that, but I see this saved. Remember, I've asked this question numerous times before. Does the word saved always mean saved from hell? Does the word fire always mean hell? Does the word, whatever, words, do you have to just automatically assume that when it says saved, that it's meaning saved as we are, we have eternal life, we're not going to die and go into the second death in the lake of fire. So we see saved that way, but do you think this verse could mean saved from getting beheaded? In other words, if you endure, if you're able to get through this tribulation period until the end, and then you'll be saved from being beheaded, and that Jesus comes back. I think it's enduring to the end of the tribulation, and I think saved is not talking about salvation, eternal life. It's talking about being saved from this death during the tribulation period.
Well, the reason I don't agree with that is because it talks about in Revelation about all of the saints that were beheaded. And then, remember those people's under the altar, and they're when is our blood going to be avenged, and all that stuff. So there are people who are saved who do get killed, so they don't make it.
They said they were killed for the testimony of Christ.
It sounds like you were interpreting what I said as that no one's beheaded. There will be many who are beheaded, and then there will be many that endure and don't get beheaded. They are able to hide out or somehow survive that 7-year period. That's what I'm talking about.
Oh, okay. I see what you're saying.
Well, what I mean is saved to go into – I'm sorry, Austin. I want to interrupt you again, but I'm sorry. I just wanted to say real quick, I was saying saved because, remember, it's the believers who are going to come through the tribulation who go into the millennium. They're saved for the millennium. The ones who are beheaded dying for their faith. They're saying, no, I will not change my faith. I will not take the mark. I choose Christ, and they're beheaded for that reason. They are, and like I said, that's where the verse it says he will overcome, wage war against the saints, overcome the saints. At that time, he can't do that to us now because we have our joy, our blessed hope, which is in that he's going to come for us before that time of testing. So it's there's a different application to it, in my opinion, based on what I've studied. I've done a lot of eschatological study, and that's the conclusion I've come to.
I want to introduce Brother Bill, who just joined us. Brother Bill, you want to say hi to everybody?
Hi, how's it going, everyone? I'm sorry I'm late. I just came back from late afternoon shopping with my wife at Costco, and I had to finish doing my workout. taking a shower.
We're glad you could make it.
Oh, thank you.
Well, there's camera and there's sound, but there's no smell-o-vision yet, Bill, so you're safe.
Yeah. Okay, do we need to go talk anymore about enduring to the end? Can I give you another verse now?
I'd like to say that that verse, I kind of agree with Eric on, but that is for the tribulation period. For the church age, an exact same verse would be Revelations 3, verse 5, and that's for this current church age, where it says, "He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before the angels."
Okay, you're jumping ahead, and it's enduring and overcoming are two different words. So I was going to go to the overcoming verse here next, but overcoming, okay, we'll discuss that one yet.
Hold on just a second. Whoa. I'm sorry. I'm looking at this whole thing, and basically what I believe is that it's he who works in me both to will and to do. If the Holy Spirit comes into me, he's going to come into the spirit of anybody who becomes a Christian at any time. And if that's the case, then the Holy Spirit is going to carry them in endurance to the end. I want to make sure that people who think that you can lose your salvation in the beginning and the end, then that would mean that your salvation was not given to you because you don't have the Spirit, because the Spirit is what carries you through. It is he who works in you both to will and to do.
Well, I agree, brother, and I think that matches the answer we're going to have for the overcomer question.
Okay.
Brother Joseph talked about he who overcometh. Well, there's another verse that tells you who the overcomers are. Does anybody know where that is?
I can't recall.
I don't know where it is, but I know what it is.
Revelations 2:23 or 26 is coming to mind.
And he that overcometh
and keepeth my works unto the end, to him I will give power over the nations. I'm reading.
Okay. I'm asking you to find the verse that tells us that we are the overcomers. Whoever believes in Christ is an overcomer. That's how we become an overcomer, by putting our faith in Christ. I wish I knew where the verse was. What?
I think it's 1 John 5:5. Who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God?
Okay.
Right.
To me.
And there's one more. The verse previous to that, so 1 John 5:4. For whosoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith.
Okay.
And can I say one more thing real quick before we move on?
Sure.
That verse, Matthew 24:13, that we were just talking about, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. We've got to be careful that we're not reading into the text or adding to it or anything like that, because I just realized this because I was doing that. It says, he that shall endure unto the end shall be saved. It doesn't say that if you don't, you won't be saved. It doesn't say any of that. It just simply says, he that does endure will be saved. And like Mitch was saying, those who have the Holy Spirit are going to endure.
Well, another thing is, I still challenge the definition of the word saved in this case. Sometimes you're saved from the lion's mouth. Sometimes you're saved from fire. Sometimes you're saved from condemnation and hell. I don't think this is talking about saved in terms of our salvation.
No, I think it's talking about saved from physical death. I remember reading this in my commentary, the Grace New Testament commentary.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Agreed, Bill. The point being, with all of these verses, is not to advocate a work salvation or one dispensation from another, just to bring up the problem verses that we often get when talking to work salvations.
Yes, exactly.
Mm-hmm. See, Brother Joe, you got a round of applause for that. Okay.
I showed Luke how to use the effects, guys. I'm sorry.
I accept your apology.
Okay, you want to do Acts 2:38?
I got it. It says, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Okay. So
did we do this the other night in the hangout with Tanya? Wasn't it Tanya's mom that brought this up?
Well, she talked about a different verse that we talked about.
Yeah, she brought up Mark. Mark something.
It was a different verse. This is the favorite verse of Pentecostals who are baptismal regenerationists, who believe you're not saved until you get wet. Okay? And this is their favorite verse. And it's also a favorite verse of those people who believe you got to repent of your sins. So we got repent of your sins, and we got get in the water as requirements. This is how they see it. So how do you explain this?
Repent in this instance, and all the instances in the New Testament, I believe, had to do with not just turning from your sin, which you would do, but that's not what saves you. It's turning to Christ. See, the thing is that your faith is what saves you in Christ. So this turning to is a changing of the mind to the gospel. So basically, it's repent means to turn to the gospel. And so when you turn to the gospel changes your heart, and as a result of that, you repent from your sins. So when you confess your sins, you're a sinner, and you need a Savior, that is to repent and look to Jesus.
Yes. And real quick, to add to that, again, keeping in context, and to support what Mitch was saying, repent here is actually the type of repent we need to talk about, which is a changing of your mind about what you see is what saves you, what actually saves you, not stopping sin or turning away from everything bad that you've done in order to get saved. Go back a few verses, verse 36, therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made the same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. He's talking to people who evidently are not convinced of that fact. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized. Change what you think saves you. Don't trust in your following of the law and turn to Christ. He's got to be your focus for salvation, not your trusting in the law and your observance of it.
Repent of what? Repent of your unbelief to belief in Christ.
To turn to belief in Christ. Right.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Austin.
Thank you. It's in Acts 20:21, and it states...
Austin, louder. Louder, Austin.
Hey, you guys hear me?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, apologize. It's Acts 20:21, and it says, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. So we know that repentance is a direction in that we repent to God, and that repentance is of unbelief, because the only sin you couldn't be forgiven for is not even showing up to be forgiven. That would be unbelief.
Right. Right.
I'm just wanted to say one more thing, and then it also says just simply and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ, and that's another faith alone verse, because it doesn't say faith in works, faith in ceasing from sin, faith in being holy. It just says repentance towards God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ.
When talking to a works salvationist, I think it's also incredibly important to let them know that one must recognize their own depravity in order to repent or turn or change their mind towards God. Without the recognition of one's depravity, there is no repentance.
Yes.
Would they turn to Christ?
Right. They have no reason to repent.
If you don't recognize your sin nature, in other words, Christ came for those who were sick, not for those who needed no physician. And without the recognition of our sickness, there is no repentance.
Okay. I want to ask everybody to keep this more in context with what Peter was talking to this group as, who was it, Eric, that read the context of a little bit. But basically, this group of people did not believe Jesus was who he claimed to be, and they killed him. They were the people who were supporting his, would not support him and were in favor of him being killed, and they were not convinced of his claims. And so when Peter is to explain, this is what you did, repent means change your mind about who you think Jesus is and believe in his claims that he is the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God, the Savior, and that's what they needed to change their mind about, Now, let me ask you about and be baptized.
Yeah, I think that's what Jay was saying. They weren't looking to Christ because they didn't think they needed him, and they didn't think that he was who he said he was, I think.
Yeah, I was asking about baptism. Everybody's talked about their repent part now. Can we talk about the baptism? These are two demands in this, and you have two groups of people that embrace this verse. The people who want to say this is repent of your sins, and the people who want to say you got to get dunked. So now we're on the baptism part. So what is this a requirement?
No, it's purely symbolic.
Yes.
Yes.
Baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
I'm talking about getting dunked in water. That's symbolic. I mean, when a person believes, he's already the Holy Spirit is bestowed upon the person at the moment of belief.
Well, in Acts, though, I think they were talking about water baptism, because isn't that what they did? I'm not saying you need to be water baptized to be saved. I'm just saying in Acts, when they were talking about it, weren't they were doing water baptism.
I believe you're right, Galaxy, on that.
But here's the thing. Here's the thing. If you go back, when we talk about baptized into Christ, okay, we talk about the baptism of Christ, which is Christ baptizes us. He baptizes us. He gives us the Holy Spirit. If we go back to the words of John the Baptist in Matthew 3:11, what does he say? I indeed baptize you with water. He separates that unto repentance. It's a symbol. It's a symbol of something that is going to come. I am simply symbolizing the baptism that is going to come from you, from the true one who is going to come, the Lamb of God. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. He doesn't mention water. He doesn't say anything about water baptism. He doesn't say anything about that. Water baptism was John the Baptist's symbology of our baptism in the Holy Spirit.
That's a very good explanation. Thank you.
Let me say that I hope everybody will write this down. I said this the other night when I was with Tanya and her mother. And there's a Bible teacher named David Geisler. He's a pastor. The YouTube channel and his church is called A Grace Place. And he's one of the best teachers on YouTube. And he did a video called titled Acts 2:38.
Luke, what's the name again? What, Geisler?
David Geisler, G-E-I-S-L-E-R.
Is that Norman Geisler's son?
No, it's not.
He's not related to Norman Geisler?
Not that I know of. I don't believe there he is. But I mean, maybe he is. I never thought of that, but he certainly has not made me aware of it. But one of the main points he makes in this is that this word baptism is shouldn't even be there. This is the wrong interpretation. We think of baptism as, what's another word for baptism? Immersion.
Immersion.
Right? So people think that this immersion automatically means immersed in water. No, immersion means we believe in Christ. That means we believe into him. We are immersed into him. And this goes along with what Eric was saying. That's the baptism that it's talking about. What I hate to even use the word baptism, because it's really saying be immersed in Christ. And he does a very thorough job, but he takes probably 40 minutes to an hour, so it's far more thorough than I can make now. But I think that's the correct way of viewing it. Plus, I think that's a big mistake. I said this to Candy the other night. I think that the rule of thumb is, when we see the word baptize in the Bible, we should assume it's spirit baptism. We should not assume it's water baptism. Unless it specifically says water, and you know that there's water nearby to be for them to be baptized in, we should assume that it's spirit baptism. That's the better way to understand this.
Okay, well, I'm looking at this verse here. It says, what shall we do? It doesn't say, what shall we do to be saved? They were cut to the heart and they said, well, what should we do? We'll repent and be baptized. I don't hear him saying, what should we do to be saved? I hear him saying, them asking him a question after being cut to the heart. What, now that we know this, what do we do? Repent and be baptized.
Mm-hmm.
So is he asking for what should you for salvation, or what should you do in return? Well, what should you do? Well, you should repent and turn to Christ, which will save you, and as a sign, you should be baptized.
Yeah, well, repentance saves us, but not repentance in the way that most people see it. Repentance saves us if we understand repentance to be a change your mind that you can work your way to heaven and admit that you need Jesus to be your Savior.
Right, right. But I'm focusing specifically on verse 37 here. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "What shall we do?" It does not add the words, "What shall we do to be saved?"
Well,
in other words, this next verse that says repent and be baptized is not a verse that's telling you how to be saved. It's telling them what to do after they found out that they were wrong and crucified their Messiah.
Well, I've never heard anybody look at it that way. Your point is correct, but I'm not sure that he's not talking. They're not really implying what do we have to do to be saved. But maybe you're right. I don't know.
Well, I don't find that in the Greek. Looking at the Greek, there's basically.
Well, what is the point of them saying what should we do? To what end are they saying that?
Well, think about it. Somebody tells you just screwed up big time and killed your Messiah. Uh-oh, what should we do? I mean, you know, this wasn't what shall we do for salvation. This was now what do we do?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it makes sense because I don't see them saying them talking about salvation here. I mean, it is salvation. Tell them to repent and turn to Christ and be mm-hmm. baptized. I would tell them the same thing. Okay, now that you know this, this is what you do.
Yeah, and Jews were all about doing stuff to show their faith. You know, I mean, they just were. So that makes sense, I guess.
You know, I just don't see the words, what shall we do to be saved? I just see the words, what shall we do now, or what shall we do?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we should read Acts 16, 30 and 31, and also the account of the thief on the cross. There's no mention of repentance. It's just believe and be saved.
Right.
Like Acts 16, 30, it says, "He then brought them out and asked, 'Sirs, what must I do to be saved?' And he said, 'Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved.'" And remember the thief on the cross? I mean, he believed right then and there, and eternal life was granted to him instantaneously for all eternity.
Right.
I mean, Jesus didn't say to him, "Oh, I'm sorry, buddy, I can't save you because you did not commit, obey, or repent." But he believed, and he was saved right then and there. Simple as that.
Yep, and he wasn't baptized either. So.
Nope.
I remember I did have a question that went along with that, but it was, "You'll be saved, you and your house." What did the "you house" mean, your house? What was that?
His family. I believe it's his family members.
But doesn't salvation come only solely by each and every older person's own personal faith with Christ? I mean, if I believed, how would that mean my family would be saved too?
Well, I think
your house.
I think he's meaning. I think when the was it, it's the is it the centurion? Is that the person that was asking the question? Refresh
yeah.
my memory. Yeah, I think he was asking that, and the question that he asked, "What must I do?" I think he was also asking along the lines of his whole family as well.
Well, I don't think he was asking about his family, but Paul expounded upon that and said, "This applies to your family too."
Right, right, yeah, that's a good way to
put it. Not that by this one man's believing on Jesus that his family are saved also, but that his family have the option also of believing on Jesus.
Yeah, in other words, pass this on to the rest of your family members. Just believe and you'll be saved.
Yeah, and they did, remember?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a verse I've always wondered about because I'm married to an unbeliever, so I always hoped that verse meant because I'm saved, he's saved, but I don't necessarily know if that's the case. I don't think it is, but I can hope.
Yeah, my wife was an unbeliever. When I first married her, she was an unbeliever, and then I fell away for 9 years, and then the Lord chastened me to bring me back, and then shortly after that, my wife became a believer.
Oh, good. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had the same situation with my wife. I was not a believer when she married me. And her prayers, her family's prayers, they came to bless me. And as a result, you know, she made intercession for me on my behalf. You know, she prayed for me, and eventually my heart changed, and I accepted Christ.
Well, praise God.
Can I ask how long it took you? I'm just curious.
I like to make this confession. I'd like to tell people, because anybody out there who's watching can take this. Okay, I was a self-proclaimed atheist. I told people they were fools if they believed in God. I did the classic, I dared God to strike me down. I did the whole nine yards. I mean, I really said some terrible things in my unbelief. My wife, I was surprised my wife was even allowed to be with me because her father, they were very patient people. And in the long run, it took pretty quickly, and it's kind of amazing in my case. I was not an easy convincing person. So she was patient. You know, she would always pull that. We'd be driving down in the car, and she'd be like, you know what, Eric, I love Jesus. And I kind of roll my eyes, and oh, brother, here we go, you know. And so don't lose, you know, you do help. You are helping. Continue to pray for him. God can soften his heart in ways you can't imagine. And he did that for me. It took me, I'd say, about a year, year and a half after being married.
Okay. That's cool.
For me, it was 7 years.
some of us are tougher than others.
Yeah, I'm going on 10 now, so. But I do. I pray every day, and he knows the gospel. I stopped nagging him, because when I noticed that was kind of pissing him off, so now
no,
I just...
Yeah, well, it does, and it's not going to help. You can't, you know, we tend to want to drag people kicking and screaming to salvation, and just can't be done.
You
just can't do it.
I just presented my wife with the simple gospel, free grace gospel of John 3:16. I just told her, I said, Jesus died for us, and I said, we're sinners. I said, if you accept his free gift of eternal life, you won't go to hell. I couldn't believe what I saw next. She burst into tears, was crying. I couldn't believe what I saw.
Oh, wow.
She was literally crying. The Holy Spirit was convicting her, you know. Yeah.
That's praise God. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Brother,
yeah.
I think that she had ears to hear.
Yeah.
And that's the problem. You never know who has ears to hear. And that's why, to me, I've always taken the approach in evangelism where I try to do the volume business. You know, I try to tell as many people and not spend my time getting all tied up with one individual for the next 5 years. It's my mission in life to get this one person to believe when maybe they don't have ears to hear and I'm casting pearls to the swine. Why I should spend my time spreading instead of putting one seed down and trying to, you know, make it grow. Let's spread thousands of seeds, and we'll find out when we get in the kingdom, you know, how many of those sprung to life.
Yep, I agree with that.
At least I like it. Okay, guys, we're going to close the show up here in a minute. So I'm going to. By the way, there are probably some more controversial verses that we could address. I think we've covered most of the biggies. If you guys want, I don't know if there's enough to occupy another whole episode. I think we've done well enough to move on. What do you guys think about that? Because I've got other topics.
Yeah.
I think that this series has been four 2-hour discussions now. And I think that we've, first, we've laid a foundation for the fact that we're saved simply by our faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior, that no work is required, and we never did discuss the lose salvation verses. Oh, yeah, I forgot that. Do you think we want to go on and talk about the verses that people maybe send us saying, well, how maybe you could lose your salvation? Or
Yeah, you should definitely cover these.
Yeah, I think we should.
Yeah, I think it's important.
Okay,
yeah.
I forgot that. So before I end this whole, this topic, let's plan on doing that next week. I've got some that people have sent me. You guys probably over this next few days, you can make a little list of any verses, not verses where you got to work to get saved, but possibly how somehow for any reason you might lose it. And we'll discuss those on this next episode, and that hopefully then I think we've exhausted this subject. So let everybody say their closing remarks and their goodbyes, and then I'll end the show to the public, and then we can all talk privately if you guys want to. And let's start with Brother Austin.
Thanks, Luke. I wanted to end it tonight with a prayer for the Philippines. They got hit pretty hard by this typhoon. Yeah. Apparently in one area they lost nearly 15,000 people, and it's supposedly going to go hit Vietnam next. And I looked, brother sent me a link, they said that this is one of the most, if not the most strongest storm that's ever touched land in the history of the world that they could ever monitor. And I was just really fascinated by it. But yeah, I mean, guys, let's give our prayers out to them, and hope they pull through.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Austin. Appreciate that. That's a good sentiment. Now we got Brother Joe or Joseph.
Well, thank you, Luke. It's a pleasure being a part of it. Hope we contributed something to the discussion.
Oh, you did. Thank you, brother. Okay, and next is Brother Eric.
Just in line with what we've been discussing, it's a very touchy topic out there. Just keep things in context that they're written in. Don't be satisfied with plucking a verse from something here and there. Get to know your whole Bible. Get to know the origins of your Bible. Get to know something about the people who wrote the Bible. There's a lot more to it than just verses at face value, and you shouldn't hinge your faith on a line plucked here and a line plucked there.
Yeah. Amen. Thank you. And we got Brother Mitch.
God, very interesting, all of this stuff. And I would definitely say that you should, if you really want to know something, you need to look at both sides of everybody's argument. It's hard to be the type of person who was completely objective. As a matter of fact, it's very hard to be completely objective. But if you never argue with yourself, then you never find out whether you were right or not. So when you're looking over these things, look at the verses carefully. Try not to when your opinions are completely formed and you've got this dogmatic, you know, orthodox way about your head, I would say look at yourself and see if you can find an argument that could beat yourself. And then praise God, hopefully you in this way you'll know both sides of the argument, so you'll be able to graciously argue it with other people.
All right, brother. Thank you. And Sister Tanya.
Hey, I just got back. Am I giving my closing statement?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Just want to say had a great time this evening and look forward to the next one.
Okay. Thank you, Tanya. And we got Brother Bill. He joined us late, but we're happy he could make it.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I'm looking forward to next week's hangout. Actually, I have a prayer request. I remember, are you guys familiar with the Voice of the Martyrs?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, we really need to pray for this lady. I just received an email. Her husband and her brother started up a church in Vietnam. And because they started up a church, the husband's brother got arrested. The husband, back in March, was basically bludgeoned to death by the communist the soldiers who arrested him. So the wife is now widowed and with four kids.
Oh, God.
Did you guys hear about that?
No.
Yeah, I get the Voice of the Martyrs newsletter.
Yeah, so she's widowed now with four small children. So yeah, they let her husband's brother go, but they bludgeoned the husband to death.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, brother. Thank you. Appreciate you coming. Well, okay. I hope everybody will join us on this is a Sunday, so the next episode will be Wednesday, 5 p.m. Pacific. It's 8 p.m. Eastern time, and I think we'll have the conclusion of this series. We're going to, if you have any verses that trouble you or you think prove that someone could lose their salvation for any reason, send them to us, and we'll discuss them next time. I also would urge everybody to, I think it would be very worthwhile if you'd watch this entire series from the beginning. We've had now 8 hours. I think every bit of it is well worth your time. But in the beginning, we prove through simple, clear verses that faith is in Jesus is the only requirement for our salvation. And then after we proved that, we went on to discuss some of the things that people are confused about, these controversial verses that are giving people difficulty. So we'll finish it up next time. And let me just say this finally, that if anybody's watching this and Jesus Christ is not your Savior, then He wants to be. I'll be right there. Jesus wants to be your Savior. We're not right now, we're not asking you to join a religion or become a religious person or follow some set of religious rules. We're asking you simply to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Believe He is your Savior, and He will save you. By saving you, that means we are doomed to die and go into the lake of fire, but He loves us so much He died for our sins. So now sin is not a problem between man and God. And He raised Himself from the dead, and that way He proved that He has power over life and death. And Jesus Christ is offering you eternal life right now. You don't have to work for it or earn it. You can't buy it. Jesus bought it. He paid for it with His own blood, and He wants to give it to you as a free gift. So just put your faith completely in Jesus Christ. Reject any idea that you could possibly work your way to heaven based upon your personal performance. And understand you're hopeless and helpless, and you need to be saved. Jesus is the only Savior. So I hope you do that. If you do, then make a comment and tell us so we can celebrate. So I'm going to end the live broadcast right now. You guys you can keep talking among yourselves if you like here. Thank you, everybody, for watching. Bless you all in the name of our great Savior God, Jesus Christ.